Yes. Check.
Check.
Check 1, 2, 3. Check. Blessed be God, Creator, Son, and Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, you have taught us to keep all your commandments by loving you and our neighbor. Grant us the grace of your Holy Spirit that we may be devoted to you with our whole heart and united to one another with pure affection. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. The first reading is from the first book of Samuel. The Philistines drew up in a line against Israel, and when the battle was joined, Israel was defeated by the Philistines, who killed about 4,000 men on the field of battle. When the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord came into the camp, all Israel gave a mighty shout, so that the earth resounded. When the Philistines heard the noise of the shouting, they said, "What does this great shouting in the camp of the Hebrews mean?" When they learned that the Ark of the Lord had come to the camp, the Philistines were afraid, for they said, "Gods have come into the camp." They said, "Woe to us, for nothing like this has happened before. Woe to us, who can deliver us from the power of these mighty gods? These are the gods who struck the Egyptians with every sort of plague in the wilderness. Take courage and be men, O Philistines, in order not to become slaves to the Hebrews as they have been to you. Be men and fight." So the Philistines fought. Israel was defeated, and they fled, everyone to his home. There was a very great slaughter, for there fell of Israel 30,000 foot soldiers. The Ark of God was captured, and the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, died. Now his daughter-in-law, the wife of Phinehas, was pregnant, about to give birth. When she heard the news that the Ark of God was captured, and that her father-in-law and her husband were dead, she bowed and gave birth, for her labor pains overwhelmed her. As she was about to die, the woman attending her said to her, "Do not be afraid, for you have borne a son." But she did not answer or give heed. She named the child Ichabod, meaning "the glory has departed from Israel," because the Ark of God had been captured and because of her father-in-law and her husband. She said, "The glory has departed from Israel, for the ark of God has been captured." Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
The Psalm 77, verses 1 to 12 and 19 to 20. God's mighty deeds recalled to the leader, according to Dutham of Aspa of Psalm. I cry aloud to God, that he may hear me. In the day of my trouble, I seek the Lord. In the night, my hand is stretched out without wearying. My soul refuses to be comforted, and I think of God, and I moan. I meditate, and my spirit faints, Selah. You keep my eyelids from closing. I am so troubled that I cannot speak. I consider the days of old, and remember the years of long ago. I commune with my heart in the night, and I meditate and search for my spirit. Will the Lord spurn forever and never again be favorable? Has his steadfast love ceased forever, and his promises at an end for all time? Has God forgotten to be gracious? Has he in his anger shut up his compassion? Selah. And I say, it is my grief that the right hand of the Most High has changed. I will call to mind the deeds of the Lord. I will remember your wonders of old. I will meditate on all your work and muse of your mighty deeds. Your way was through the sea, your path through the mighty waters, yet your footprints were unseen. You led your people like a flock by the hand of Moses and Aaron.
The second reading is from St. Paul's letter to the Romans. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. Amen. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
The Holy Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
I have said these things to you while I am still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I am going away and I am coming to you. If you loved me, you would rejoice that I am going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you this before it occurs, so that when it does occur, you may believe. I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. He has no power over me, but I do as the Father has commanded me, so that the world may know that I love the Father. Rise, let us be on our way. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Let us pray. God, uphold me that I may acclaim you. May the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be now and always acceptable in your sight as I speak in your name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Sisters and brothers, I invite us to reflect on all the readings, but in particular the first reading, 1 Samuel chapter 4, verse 22. The wife of Phinehas, Eli's son, said, "The glory has departed from Israel, for the ark of God has been captured." The glory has departed from Israel, for the ark of God has been captured. The story is told of a monk who, while sweeping the floor of the monastery, was asked if the end of the world should come immediately, what would he do? His response was, "I would keep sweeping the floor." This approach to the principle that life goes on irrespective of the challenges and opportunities which present themselves seems to have been the posture of the wife of Phinehas in the first reading. Read in its totality, chapter 4 of 1 Samuel describes a very violent situation accompanied by death, destruction, destitution, and distress. Yet it seems the writer wants to make a point, like the monk, that life goes on. Despite the gory details and the challenges which confront us on a day-to-day basis, life goes on. For the writer of 1 Samuel also, women are important as we make the transition day after day. Here in chapter 4, the broader narrative is the story of God at work in the life of Israel. And then, as if out of nowhere in chapter 4, we are introduced to the wife of Phinehas, who, though not given a name, which suggests she's not as important as men like Eli or Phinehas for that matter. Nonetheless, the women are important and the wife of Phinehas is important. Women are introduced into the text to show that they have a key role to play when the presence of God is not or cannot be discerned and experienced in life generally, but in difficult and challenging situations in particular. What was the difficulty facing the Israelites in the passage? The writer says the difficulty is that God's glory departed from Israel because the ark of God was captured. In the Old Testament tradition, the presence of God is also described as the glory of God. And this presence is described in the Hebrew as the light of God. The light of God is also the presence of God. So, for example, in Exodus chapter 13, verse 21, God's glory is described as a pillar of cloud, which accompanied the Israelites by day as they made their way through the wilderness, and the pillar of fire by night as they journeyed also on in the wilderness. So God's glory, which is also light, is this perpetual presence, calling Israel and by extension calling all people to go through life, to carry on. And this light is of particular importance, especially as we face the challenges and the difficulties of life. But the writer of 1 Samuel wants to say something else, as I said earlier, by introducing woman into the narrative. And this is something we learn from the prophet Isaiah, who has this to say in Isaiah 49, verse 15. Can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion on the child she has born? Though she may forget, God says, I will not forget you. Here, the prophet describes God as having the characteristics of females. The nature of God, the character of God, is as compassionate and nurturing and caring as a woman. In the same way, a woman will go the extra mile to care for the child. Of course, we know there are exceptions. But the woman's compassion and care for her children knows no bounds. And so the writer of 1 Samuel is suggesting that in the midst of the crisis Israel is experiencing and going through, God is with them as a mother is prepared to be with her child. Some time ago, I saw the story of a mother in the park with her child. The child wandered to the edge of a pond in which there were crocodiles. And one of the crocodiles came up and snatched the child. And the mother, without thinking, jumped into the pond, wrestled with the crocodile, rescued the child, and came back on land, and she collapsed. Of course, she was rushed to hospital. When she recovered, she was asked, how did you do that? She said, I never thought about it. I just knew I had to rescue my child. That was what was uppermost in my mind. That is what is uppermost in the mind of God, to rescue all people, and especially those in challenging and difficult situations. I'm very grateful to Reverend Rose for introducing me to the women's lectionary developed by Dr. Wilda Gaffney. I am accustomed to preaching from the Revised Common Lectionary, which replaced the older lectionary, which was exclusive for the traditional churches. Now we have the Revised Common Lectionary, which is ecumenical in its ethos. The women's lectionary is a new phenomenon developed and popularized within the last 3 years. Upon reading the lessons for today and a brief background on Professor Gaffney, I could immediately tell that part of her emphasis is the need to revolutionize the way we read and understand Scripture. And so it's not by accident that she invites us to pay attention to women in the narratives of Scripture generally, and of course in the narrative of 1 Samuel today. As I mentioned earlier, the women described in 1 Samuel are being used by the writer to move the narrative forward. But they are playing another important role. They are examples of the way God intervenes in crisis situations. Today, we also face numerous crises. For example, in 2020, the year COVID-19 took over the world like a tsunami. There were 23.8 deaths per 100,000 live births. This is to be compared with 20.1 in 2019. With an increase of almost 3% over the 1 year period, this shows that women remain vulnerable, extremely vulnerable, during childbirth. And so the writer 1 Samuel, although writing hundreds of years, thousands of years before 2020, is nonetheless lifting up the risk, the crises that women face generally, but in the process of bearing children, giving birth in particular. Professor Gaffney, in lifting up and framing the lectionary around the stories of women, is suggesting that we need to pay attention to the way we read Scripture generally, and in those references like this one, where women are highlighted. In the psalm, though there is no specific reference to women, nonetheless, there is the emphasis on what to do when we are in a crisis. What we are to do when we're in a crisis, we are to cry out to God. In the gospel reading, again, there's no specific reference to women, but there's an interesting reference which Professor Gaffney wants us to pay attention to, and that is the reference to the Holy Spirit. Because she makes the point that the way biblical translators generally treat with the Holy Spirit and generally the Spirit of God is often devoid of the feminine character of the Spirit. Because she says God as creator is very often associated with the masculine, and so is God the Son. And translators, she says, fail very often to emphasize, accentuate, and affirm God, the Holy Spirit, as the feminine aspect and dimension of God. So the writer 1 Samuel wants us to pay attention to the fact that God comes to us as a woman. At a time when Israel was facing a deep crisis. Its leader, Eli, died suddenly when he was told that his sons were killed in war. And so Scripture opens for us some avenues of connecting with God when we are in difficult situations. And so one way to connect with God when we are in difficult situations is to get in touch with the feminine side of God. This is what the Eucharistic prayer we will pray later holds up and affirms for us. Later in the Eucharistic prayer, we are going to pray these words. Sanctify these elements by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and the blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life. What do we mean by this sanctification? It suggests two things. First, sanctification is a gift, which suggests that in the same way God gave the divine self to Israel in their time of crisis, and a child was born, so it is God gives the divine self to us in the Eucharist, in the body and blood of Jesus Christ. And guess what? New things happen. In Isaiah chapter 11, verse 2, the prophet tells us that when the Holy Spirit comes upon people, we are given gifts to carry out the work of God. We are given the spirit of wisdom, the spirit of understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. In other words, God gives us all the tools necessary to go through the challenges and the difficulties which we confront on a daily basis. So the role of women in carrying forward the purposes of God is what is being presented to us today. And if we are to make this even more important, then we must pay attention to the dimensions, all the dimensions of the lives of women. And one of them is the example I gave earlier, and that is maternal mortality. If we are to grow and develop as societies and nations, then it's important that we prepare young girls in their maturation for becoming mothers. We prepare young boys in their maturation for becoming fathers. So in the Jamaican language, we say, big up all women and girls, because they are important in carrying forward the purposes of God. But there's a second thing about the sanctification for which we will pray in the Eucharistic prayer. Apart from being a gift from God, sanctification is a call to service. At the end of the service this morning, we will hear again these familiar words. The Mass is ended. Our service in the world continues. At the big picture level, our service in the world is for all God's people, but especially for those who are most vulnerable. I spend much of my ministry working with people living with HIV. And I'm able to see firsthand the vulnerabilities and the crises and the challenges that people confront on a daily basis. And much of this is really about how people treat with each other. Lack of respect and dignity. In this story I told at the beginning about the monk, what it suggests really is, in the same way the monk sweeps the floor as part of his regular day-to-day duties, so it is with us. Just practice daily respect and dignity for girls, for women, for everyone. Because this is part of affirming and celebrating
the glory of God in our presence. So the glory departed from Israel, but it was restored in the gift of the Holy Spirit to the church. That glory is still present with us. And so I want to conclude with a poem written in the 19th century. The writer of this poem, William Wallace, made popular a saying which emerged in the 1840s. The hand that rocks the cradle rules the world. And this poem is designed to affirm, celebrate, and accentuate the role of women in nurturing lives and continuing the purpose of bearing life and light in the world. Blessings on the hand of women. Angels guard its strength and grace. In the palace, cottage, hovel, oh, no matter where the place, would that never storms assailed it, rainbows ever gently curled, for the hand that rocks the cradle is the hand that rules the world. Infancies, the tender fountain, power may with beauty flow, mothers first to guide the streamlets, from them souls unresting grow. Grow on for the good of evil, for good or evil, sunshine streamed or evil hurled, for the hand that rocks the cradle is the hand that rules the world. Woman, how divine your mission. Here upon our natal sod, keep, oh keep the young heart open always to the breath of God. All true trophies of the ages are from mother love impearled, for the hand that rocks the cradle is the hand that rules the world. Blessings on the hand of women, fathers, sons, and daughters cry. And the sacred song is mingled with the worship in the sky. Mingles where no tempest darkens, rainbows evermore are hurled. For the hand that rocks the cradle is the hand that rules the world. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. I invite us to stand as we affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen or unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The Prayers of the People, Book of Common Prayer, page 392. In peace we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, and Carly, our bishop, and for all bishops, for Rose, our priest, and other ministers.
For all who serve God in his church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation.
For Ukraine, Ethiopia, and any other war-torn areas in the world.
For Dawn, Marianne, Janet, the Farrell family, Bob, Finland and Sweden, Vincent, Nancy, Mary, Susan and Saul, and Allison, Janice. Nancy. We pray for those who are traveling this week. O God, whose glory fills the whole creation, and whose presence we find wherever we go, preserve those who travel, in particular all these gathered here, and those who travel with them. Surround them with your loving care, protect them from every danger, and bring them in the journey to journey's end. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We pray for the committee of the month, which is the property and memorial gardens committee. We pray in this month of July, which is Disabilities Pride Month. Watch over your children, O God. Are there any birthdays? Any birthdays? Okay, for any anniversaries? We will exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. For Oscar Tate, who died on July 4th. For Levere Dean, the brother of Esther Johnson, who died on July 5th. For Abby O.C. Green, Abby, Chelsea Green's father, whose funeral was yesterday. For the people
who have died in all the mass shootings that continue weekly in the United States.
Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Who put their trust in you.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us.
Most merciful Father,
In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so hold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness. Keep you in the power of the Holy Spirit in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace of Christ, thank you, thank you. Peace, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you so much. Please, Mr. Morris, I'm good. Good to see you again.
So as you all know, we have announcements later in the service, after the blessing. But the one announcement, again, because we have guests here, is how we distribute communion during this time of COVID. We will have, and it will be Bishop Minot, standing over there, which is on your left side, with hosts. And you can either take a host from him, holding your hands out flat so there's no physical contact between people, and you can then choose, you can choose to go back to your seats without receiving any consecrated wine, or then you can go to the person who was over on your right to drink from the chalice. The other option is to not immediately take the host from Bishop Minot, but to tell him you want it intincted or dipped in the wine, and he will then drop it into your hands. So I just follow the directions of the ushers. And now the offertory sentence, it's not in there. Do you want me to? Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give you thanks, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, for by water and the Holy Spirit, you have made us a new people in Jesus Christ, O Lord, to show forth your glory in all the world. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. When he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine. Then he gave thanks. He gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of the new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament, serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, and that the last day bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. This we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. As our Savior Christ has taught us, now we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
Joining with those who are with us online, let us pray together. Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the blessed sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things and long for you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. As though you have already come, I embrace you and unite myself entirely to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God. Body of Christ. Body of Christ. Body of Christ. Thank you. post-communion prayer, let us pray together. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood, your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Sisters and brothers, just before I do the blessing, I'd like to say thanks to Reverend Rose for being so hospitable and kind and generous with the pulpit and the altar, the pulpit yesterday and both the pulpit and the altar this morning. So thank you for being so hospitable and generous. Bow your heads, pray for God's blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you this day and forevermore.
And now let me begin the announcements by giving thanks for the Reverend, the Right Reverend Garth Minot, our celebrant and preacher today, preacher yesterday, and for coming from Jamaica to be with us this weekend. Thank you very much. Jarek, do you want to say anything about the dinners for? Okay, as a reminder, this is being sponsored by the men's ministry, but I think they're inviting the women, if they want, to provide some of the food. That's all I can say as I'm reading this.
I'd like to hear from the men.
But you want to hear from the men, he is saying. Okay. Okay, and continued ask for money to the boiler fund, and I don't know whether anyone went yesterday, but exercise class with Audie moves to Wednesdays at 6:30. Just read the bulletin for the details. And soup kitchen is October 1st, and I know October feels like it's a long time away, but it isn't. Not in here, but the funeral for Oscar Tate will be on Friday, July 29th. At 11 a.m. We don't have any of the other details right now. And as you probably know, I am going away. I'll be somewhat home in Ocean Grove, but I'm gonna be away for 8 days in up on Cape Cod. So the wardens will know how to get in touch with me if there's an emergency, because in an emergency, I'm mostly available. And now,
hi, everybody. Most of you know I'm Donna Smith. And
hi, everyone. I'm Jackie Hunter, Flora's mom.
Flora's daughter.
Flora's daughter.
Okay. Anyway, Jackie and I recently attended an event at SOPAC, our Performing Arts Center, right here in South Orange. And it was about trying to get people to attend a play that's going to be shown for 2 weeks only at SOPAC every night. And it's destined to go to Broadway, and this is the worldwide premiere. It's a political satire about the current political climate, so it should be pretty fun to see. The cool thing about a world premiere is that during the 2 weeks, they will be listening to the audience react to the show, and if they find things they need to tweak, they will tweak them. So throughout the 2 weeks, the play may change a little. Or a lot as they go along, because they really need people in the seats. It's not Broadway prices, so it's easy to attend. And we're just hoping, I know I've emailed some of you about this already, but hoping that that more will be able to buy tickets and get their seats and help in this production that could go to Broadway. It's really exciting. So Jackie's going to talk about getting in touch with us.
All right, so this will be in the email blast. We can also connect you with former trustee Steve Schnall, who's part of this production. Please reach out to Donna or myself. I'll give you my cell phone. I know not everyone is online, and we can help you get tickets. My cell phone number is 973-634-1357. And again, my name is Jackie. And, you know, we'd love for everyone to try and participate and, you know, enjoy our local SOPAC theater. Because normally something like this would go to the paper mill in Millburn, but, you know, it's going to be at SOPAC, which is phenomenal. So hope to see a lot of you there, okay? Thank you.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
So much.